Hello guys, so I wanted to do a video on sourdough starter and how I make my sourdough bread, different things I make with my sourdough starter because you have a lot of discard and a lot of people throw it out, which is a terrible, terrible thing. It's a lot of wasted stuff, and really there's a bunch of stuff that you can do with sourdough starter. So what is sourdough starter and why do we care? Well, because I tell you so. Just kidding. So sourdough starter is very, very good for you. It has prebiotics in it. It's pretty much pre-fermented, pre-digested almost. So the kids and I went through science a week or two ago about microbes. That there's good and there's bad microbes. There's viruses, which are obviously the bad microbes, and there's good microbes, which are in fermented foods, sauerkraut, fermented vegetables. All those things are really good for you. Now, when COVID started, I don't know how many years ago now, I've lost track. Even before that, I made a lot of homemade bread. And we call store-bought bread air bread because it pretty much has nothing good in it for you. Even the whole wheat bread is still really not good for you. It's missing all of the nutrients that you would want in whole wheat bread. So anyways, for those of you that like store-bought whole wheat bread, I'm sorry, but you're still eating kind of air. I started making homemade bread years ago, even before COVID. So when COVID hit, I could not find yeast anywhere because it was like the new thing for everyone to be home. They were baking a lot. They were, you know, yeast was like $15 for a jar of yeast. And we had been making, even before I started making homemade bread, homemade pizza dough every Friday night. So it was nowhere to be found. I didn't know what to do. So I started getting into sourdough starter again. So sourdough starter is pretty much what they use way back before there was store-bought yeast. It catches its own yeast from the air is pretty much what happens. It starts a fermentation process. So anything that's fermented, people do kombucha is a huge thing. Kefir is a huge thing. It's all those natural fermentation process that's got a lot of prebiotics and probiotics in it for you. What happens is the microbes inside of it, usually there's some form of sugar that the microbes eat. It off-gasses, giving it the fizziness, the bubbles. It's really good for your gut health, number one. It helps feed the good bacteria and keep low the bad bacteria in your digestive system, which a lot of health issues nowadays, a lot of autoimmune is directly linked to your gut health. And since I have a lot of autoimmune diseases, I'm very concerned about gut health. So we were absolutely no sugar for just less than a year. And then I ended up with needing surgery back in May. And before that, I had to wait for surgery for about 3 months. I was in terrible pain. I could not stand for very long or do much of anything. So pretty much anything that's no sugar is homemade. You can't find it anywhere else. that whole no sugar thing just kind of went out the window. And nobody else really does no sugar. Our church was wonderful. They were aware we were no sugar, so when they brought meals and stuff, they made sure there was no sugar in it, and it was just wonderful. They were so sweet. So anyways, we kind of got off on the not having sugar. We went to a lot of processed foods, and then of course we were fixing the house up to sell. I think we listed the house for sale like 2 weeks after my surgery. So, and of course, major abdominal surgery takes several months even to recover from, but we were pretty much thrown into packing and moving. So recovery was interesting. And then moving is stressful, and we did not obviously have very many amenities here, so cooking was difficult. We got way far away from home-cooked foods and no sugar and everything. But now that we're more settled, I am getting back to no sugar. Dan quit coffee last Monday. He had some yesterday for Sunday. It's like his treat. I've still been doing coffee every day with my sugar in it, the cane, raw cane sugar. I'm sorry, if I want coffee, I want sugar in it, or I don't want coffee. So, we're trying to get back over to no sugar again, and get back into the sourdough starter. It's very good for you. And honestly, the bread is just so delicious, and we all love it. We make pancakes with our sourdough starter. We do our pizza dough. We try to get it in as much as possible because of how good it is for you. It's good for you if you're diabetic as well, because it doesn't have the huge spike in your blood sugar as normal bread does. As well as, there was one other thing and you distracted me. Those that are gluten intolerant, it's not gluten-free, but it's a lot easier for people to digest if they're trying to stay away from gluten. So it's really tasty. So, you know, to start your sourdough starter, people get very intimidated. It's really not hard. Everybody's sourdough starter, which I think is really neat, is going to be unique to their own house, because every house has different things floating around. And so, and I just love the smell of it. When you're starting your sourdough starter, you're going to use your all-purpose flour. Let me get my recipe here. I know it. So it's a half a cup of your all-purpose flour and a quarter cup of water. That's it. You're going to mix it together really well. I use a lot of mason jars because the sourdough starter is very, it turns into like cement once it dries. So tip number one is always wash the jar immediately when you're done. Don't let it sit and harden up, because then you have to soak it for like 3 days. You don't want it clogging up your sink. Tip number two, don't ever dump your sourdough starter down any drain, because it will clog it up and your husband will be very, very mad at you. So that's number two. So to start your sourdough starter, again, it's half a cup and then a quarter cup of water. Sometimes, depending on the brand of flour and the environment, the humidity of your house, sometimes the sourdough starter will look a bit runny. You want it thicker than pancake mix. And then sometimes, you know, like us, we've got the wood stove going. No, we're not doing that right now. Go back in the room. With the fireplace, it makes it really dry in here. So when I first started, I had to throw it away because it dried out really fast. So you want it a certain consistency. It's kind of gooey. It's like a little bit thicker than probably a pancake mix. But that's what you want. You're going to mix it together. You're going to let it sit for 24 hours. Usually a paper towel over the top of it so dust and bugs don't get in it, with a canning ring around it. You want it to be able to breathe and get air but not get stuff in it. I do fermented vegetables. So this I got at Walmart. It comes with little rings for fermenting vegetables. But it has this little flap in here with holes, so it can let air flow in but keep it. So this is just easier for me, because sometimes with the paper towels, when you get sourdough around the ring and you put the paper towel on, it gets stuck on there, and again, you're soaking it for days to try and get it all off. So this is just easier. It gets the airflow it needs. It was really cheap. I think I got two of these lids for $5 with the other stuff that I needed for fermented. But again, you can just use a paper towel and a rubber band or the ring around it. So once you mix that together, you're going to let it sit for 24 hours. Now the next day, you're going to add half a cup of flour, quarter cup of water, maybe a little less, maybe a little more, depending. You should be able to tell by then if it's too watery or too dry. Then you're going to let that sit for 24 hours. Now you should by then start to see some bubbles in it. I'm going to show you this real quick. Hopefully my phone won't fall. And you can see bubbles inside there. It should start bubbling. If not by then, don't worry. You can still let it go a couple more days. But on day two, you're going to add it again. And then on day three, after it sits for 24 hours, you're going to discard down to a half a cup of starter. You can save the discard if you would like, or you can just get rid of it. Again, it kills me to get rid of it because it's almost like you're wasting all that stuff. So you're going to discard down to a half a cup again, and you're going to do it again. You're going to add a half a cup of flour, a quarter cup of water. And by the third and fourth day of doing this, it should really be getting active and bubbly. Now what I do with my discard is I keep a mason jar in the fridge, and anytime I discard, I just add it to that jar. It can last 3 to 4 days in the fridge, and then I just use it in whatever recipe I'm doing. Usually in the pizza dough, the sourdough naan bread, I have a recipe for sourdough cornbread, the sourdough pancakes. So I save the discard. Cat, get out of here, please. She loves the smell of sourdough. I don't know what it is. She loves sourdough bread, and if you leave it out, she will try to eat it. No, you can't have it. This is Kiki. She's my assistant today. She's just a turd. Can you get your butt out of the camera? Thank you. Okay. So that's what I do with the discard. Like I said, I just keep adding to it every 3 or 4 days. You know, I'll have 2 cups or more in there, and then I'll make pancakes with it usually. So you're just going to keep repeating the process on day 3 or 4. Like I said, it should be getting bubbly and active. It should be very happy. You must name your sourdough starter. Years ago when we started this, Sayla picked the name Shalia. So this is like Shalia number 6 because we've started it 6 times or so. There's been times I've forgotten to feed it and or it's gotten moldy because I haven't used it for so long. So this is Shalia the 6th or 7th or 8th. I can't remember. So everyone usually picks a name for their sourdough. I've heard Gloria, all sorts of stuff. So anyways. So on day 3 or 4, active and bubbly, it should be ready to be used for whatever recipe you have. There's so many sourdough recipes out there. I've tried sourdough several times. It's always come out super dense, not light and fluffy, and all the air bubbles in it. It just hasn't worked, so I usually stuck to, you know, the pizza dough and other things like that. Recently, Helen got into the sourdough starter, and she has like perfected the sourdough bread. So I stole her recipe, and it has been wonderful. The key is to fold, 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 fold. So you fold and rest, you fold and rest, fold and rest. Pretty much an all day process, and let it sit overnight, and it comes up beautifully. So, so you just keep it going. After day 3 or 4, you're just going to continue to discard. It depends on what recipe you're using. So this is a 1/2 gallon mason jar, and I fed it last night. I was up to about a cup, and I fed it. So I fed it a cup and about 3/4 cup of water. I discarded it and saved it. So I discarded down to a cup, and then I added another cup of flour and just under a cup of water. And so it was at 2 cups, and now it's gone up to about 5 cups. So when you let it sit for 24 hours, it'll get really high, and then it'll kind of settle back down by morning time. It's best to feed it regularly at the same time every day. You can store it in the fridge if you're going to be away for a while. I can put some links on the video or do more in-depth video about how to store it, how to wake it back up, you know, what to do if it's not looking well. So if you start to get like liquid on the top because you've forgotten it a day or two, it's okay. That liquid's not bad unless it's like gray or black liquid. You're going to want to discard it and start over. It happens. Sometimes you forget it. So that's pretty much what you do. You do have to feed it every day. If you need a break, you put it in the fridge. You'll feed it let it rise, and then put it in the fridge, and once a week or so, you're going to feed it, put it back in the fridge, just to keep it going. It's not hard to start. You don't need to be worried. It's not going to go moldy. I don't think I've ever had it go moldy. So it really should just be bubbly every single day. So for my recipe, last week I tried an experiment because I really don't like using store-bought all-purpose flour. It doesn't have much nutrients to it at all. But for the first time making the bread, that's what I did because that's what the recipe called for. Most of the homemade bread I made that I use regular yeast for, I've been using our wheat berries and grinding them. I'll usually grind like 8 cups of wheat berries. We'll fill this thing up. The wheat berries, what's different about wheat berries is the wheat is still in its kernel form before it's processed. And what happens is, you know, way back when everyone used to grind their own corn, grind their own wheat. But as the years went by, freshly ground wheat does not have a long shelf life. After 10 days, it starts to lose all the nutrients in it. So I don't grind 50 pounds of wheat at a time because by the time I use those 50 pounds, the nutrients are going to be gone. What's nice about the whole kernel is it's going to have all the natural fats. It's going to have all the natural nutrients. All-purpose flour bought from the store, even whole wheat flour bought from the store, a lot of it's been stripped from the good fats in it because the fat is what's going to make it go bad and not be shelf stable. So they extract all those nutrients out, so you're missing out on the nutrients just so they can keep it shelf stable. So we noticed when we started eating this, a lot of my digestive problems went away. I could not, ever since Creed was born, I've had horrible issues with peanut butter and weird things. And for a while, I could not eat any sort of carb first thing in the morning for breakfast. It would kill my stomach. I'd be bloated. It was awful. So I couldn't even eat oatmeal. It would just bother my stomach. But since using this, like, I can grind the wheat berries and have 2 slices of bread in the morning, and it doesn't hurt my stomach. So I don't know what they do to flour in the store, but I'm telling you, this is so much better for you. And things normally that are better for you require more work, which is why most people don't do it. But, you know, I make time for it. I do it because it's better for us. It's not always easy. It is certainly not more convenient, but in the long run, it's better for us. So last week I did an experiment. I did half the all-purpose flour in the recipe and half of the freshly ground wheat flour. And it still rose beautifully. It was not hard. It was not dense. It was so tasty because it had that sourdough flavor. But the ground flour adds like a nutty flavor to things. So it was really good. We were all really happy with it. So that's what I'm going to do again today. I'm going to double batch it. Mostly because just making one loaf is in that cook oven where you have to get the wood going to warm it up. It's not worth it to do just one loaf. So I do 2 loaves. Everybody else is different. So this recipe for the sourdough bread is in grams. So it goes by weight. We have our kitchen scale here. I'm going to weigh the flour out. I'm going to do it in 2 separate bowls, 1 loaf for each bowl, just because the way that it shapes, it's easier that way. Excuse me. So let me see here. I will put the recipe in the description below. I know this video is kind of longer, but you'll get over it. If you really want to know, you'll get over it. All right, so let me see if I can back this up a little bit. All right, so make sure when you're doing it on the scale, you have to put your bowl on and zero the scale out. So this recipe for 1 loaf is 500 grams of flour, 375 grams of water, 100 grams of starter, 10 grams of salt. So this is all in steps. Like I said, I'll put the recipe in the description below the video. So right now, the sourdough, when you make your sourdough bread, you're going to want to feed it early in the morning, let it go for 4 hours so it can be really active, and then add it to your sourdough recipe. So I'll just go through this recipe quickly. You're going to measure out your stuff. The first step is you're only mixing the flour and water together. So 500 grams of flour, 375 grams of water. You're going to stir it together and you're going to let it sit for 2 hours covered in a warm spot. After 2 hours, you're going to add your 100 grams of starter and you're going to mix that together and you're going to let it sit again in a warm spot, not too hot, probably about 75 to 85 degrees. You're going to let that mixture sit for another hour. Then you're going to mix in your 10 grams of salt and you're going to fold it for 4 minutes. So when you're folding, you got your dough in the middle, you're going to take one corner, fold it over, push it down. Turn the bowl, fold it over, push it down. And you're going to do that for 15 minutes. I'm sure most of you know how to kind of fold and knead a dough. So you're going to fold for 15 minutes. Now remember, folding is very important for your sourdough bread. Okay, it's going to add air bubbles. You want it nice and light. You're going to build up the gluten when you're stretching and folding it. It's very important. So, fold for 15 minutes after you add the salt. You're going to let that sit again for an hour. You're going to fold it for a couple of minutes, sit for an hour. You're going to do that 4 times. Okay, so every hour, 4 times. And then once that's done, you can leave it for a while and you can bake after, you know, let it sit for an hour and then bake it. Or what we have found and what Helen has found best is you let it sit overnight. Because with all of this, if you feed it at 8, your starter's ready by noon. And then this is about like a 5-6 hour process with all this folding. So it works really well if you let that dough sit in the fridge overnight. It's even better if you let it sit 2 days in the fridge. The way that the sourdough gets in through all the bread and helps ferment it better, it is so good. So I've only done it one night because I'm too impatient and I want bread. So I usually let it sit overnight, and in the morning, usually around noon, I get the wood stove going. You know, it takes me an hour and a half to get the wood cook oven up and running. So by noon, and then I put it in the oven. So let me see here. So once you've done all your folding and resting, what I do is I have a bowl or a colander, whatever, with a towel. Don't use paper towel, it'll stick to it. So with a towel, I flour the surface of the towel, I put the dough in there in the fridge, I cover it, you know, with another towel in a bowl or a shower cap you can put over it, let it sit in the fridge overnight. Now when the next morning comes to bake, or whenever you're going to bake it, you preheat your oven at 450 degrees. It really cooks better when it's in a Dutch oven with some sort of lid, just the way that it keeps the moisture in, and it's almost like going from cold fridge into the oven shocks it, and it, you know, rises really well in the oven. So you preheat to 450. You also, another trick is preheating the Dutch oven. So I have a cast iron, a deep skillet, and then one that probably about that big that can fit on top. So that's what I do. While the oven's preheating, the last 10 minutes or so, I try to throw the Dutch oven in there so it can preheat as well. I take the dough out probably a half hour before I bake it, and it'll start to rise and get a little bubbly too while you're waiting for it. I flip it over onto a powdered surface out from the bowl and towel. I sprinkle some flour on top of it. You can cut little design into the top if you want. Then I put it on, I'm sorry, I roll it out onto parchment paper. So I flour the parchment paper a little bit, roll the dough out onto it, flour the surface a little. You can do little slits in it for design. You lift the parchment paper up and write it. It's just so much easier on the parchment paper to lift it in and out of the Dutch oven when it's hot. It goes right in the Dutch oven. You cover it up. It goes in there at 450 for 30 minutes. Then you take the lid off and you put it back in the oven. Depending on your oven, 10, 15 minutes, it gets really nice and brown and crispy over the top of it. And then you let it rest. It's very tempting to cut it right then and there and eat it. But when you do that, trying to cut it just tears the bread apart. So it's really best to wait an hour before you start to eat it. So I'm just going to show you the first step while we're here talking. I got to start my scale all over again. You know, two loaves of bread just do not last long in our house. It lasts a day, a loaf. So I will only hopefully have to be baking every 2 days, but I doubt it. But we make, like I said, we make naan bread, which is really yummy. We, you know, do our pizza dough, a naan bread pizza dough. I can put all these recipes on there if you want. All right, so that's 500 grams of flour. Again, like I said, I do half and half, so half of the all-purpose flour and then half of the ground wheat berries and flour. I'm going to experiment today and do, usually I do half and half, but I want to get as much of the ground flour in as possible. Why is this? Oh, I forgot to zero my scale. But I really want to get away from the all-purpose flour as much as possible. So, I like to experiment. So I'm going to see if I do 500 grams is almost 4 cups of flour. So I'm going to try 3 cups of the whole wheat flour that I ground in one loaf of bread to see how much I can get in there. That is the problem with the ground flour, is it is can make the bread a lot denser and heartier, which we're used to, but I've had other people that aren't used to it come over for bread and they're like, oh my goodness, I'm so full, you know, because the bread is just, can be a lot denser. Sometimes with my old recipe that I used 100% of the ground flour, it doesn't rise properly and it doesn't build up gluten as well. So I end up having to add wheat gluten powder to it to help it rise better. So it's 500 grams of flour, and then we're going to have 375 grams of water. I'm going to mix that up, let it sit for 2 hours, and then continue on with the rest of the recipe. So if you have any questions, let me know. It takes all day, so there's no way I can record all day how it goes. But I wanted to just kind of chat with you and let you know what the recipe is. And again, I will put the recipe in the description below, and also some links for the other recipes we like the sourdough pancakes and the sourdough pizza crust, stuff like that, that you can use your discarded starter for, so that way you're not wasting it. So I hope you guys enjoy the video and that you get brave enough to try some sourdough starter. If you have any questions or you have problems with it, let me know and I will try to address them. Bye.